Okay.
So please, yeah,
okay, thank you. Thank you for, it's my pleasure to come in to have a lecture here. I did last time and I really enjoyed. So thank you again for inviting me to this class. So let me start with my introduction. Here is the topics that I'm going to cover. Let me briefly introduce myself and who I am and what I'm doing. And then I'll go through some historical part of the serious games and also the current trend and the future perspectives. And my name is Toru FUJIMOTO. I'm a project assistant professor, Tokunin Koshi, at the University of Tokyo. And my research background, academic background, is education technology, especially on game-based learning and online education. I got a PhD at Pennsylvania State University in the United States. And so I'm working on several projects on game-based learning. I started since 2003 or so. And I published several books on serious games and gamification recently. This is my early research work I conducted. This is a game called A Tale in the Desert, which is a massively multiplayer online game, MMORPG type of game. And then this is, I conducted a research on the user community, player community of this game. This game is non-violent, very peaceful game. And then if you design a game without violence or action type of thing, then I was interested in how the user interact with each other without such kind of action or violent type of element in the game. So you can learn this from this game. Through playing this game, you can learn about how you can collaborate or how you can take a leadership or work with other people. Then, so this is work I did 10 years ago. And I'm still working on this type of user community research. This is a game, do you know this game? The Neko Atsume. This game is produced by a game company called Hitpoint, which is in Kyoto. The company is in Kyoto. And this game got a huge hit. And now it's more than 90 million downloads worldwide. So not just in Japan, it's very popular in the US or other countries. And I also conducted a user survey on this game. And then this game contains lots of elements regarding Japanese culture and some Japanese items like kotatsu or kakejiku or some other stuff. And also you can learn about how cats behaves in the games briefly. It's a kind of very simplified game and very simple. If you download the game on your smartphone, on the Android or iPhone, then you can play and you see how people interact on social media. Like if you can share with your screenshot of the game via Facebook or Twitter. And people just creating their story or scenarios and just talking about their cats, like as if they have a real cat. Oh, wow. So very interesting user community it exists now. So I'm doing this kind of study for 10 years or so. So and also I'm working on building a research community. I'm working at Japan Society for Educational Technology, JSET. JSET have a special interest group on game-based learning and online education. So we're putting together the research theme between the online education and game-based learning, and find out very interesting research topics within that area. And also my research unit called Ludix Lab. I started this research unit 3 years ago, and then I'm doing sort of lecture series, workshop regarding online or game-based learning. So, and recently we published a book called Basic Guide for Game-Based Corporate Training. This is available on Amazon Kindle. You can just download and read it, but it's in Japanese only, so. Yeah, because there are several books in English is already available. So I try to write in Japanese so that the Japanese people can read and understand. Yeah. And this is my main project at the University of Tokyo. Aside from game-based learning research, I'm working on MOOCs, massive open online courses at the University of Tokyo. University of Tokyo offering MOOCs on Coursera and edX. Kyoto University is offering MOOCs on edX, that you know maybe. And then the courses are really great. And at the University of Tokyo, I'm working on planning and then producing and operating those courses, working with those great instructors. We produce 8 courses already, and in different type of topics, research topics. So I just briefly show you what kind of courses are already produced from our university. Okay, so this is what I'm doing at the University of Tokyo. This course we just released last month, in September. The course called Studying at Japanese Universities. This course is great for the students who are interested in coming to Japan and studying at some Japanese universities, not just for the University of Tokyo, but like you, coming to Kyoto University or Kyushu University, or there are several great programs at Japanese University, right? So we want to promote more, and then people, we want to provide this course to be ready to come to Japan and studying at the Japanese University. So this course supports the student to prepare their study plan and then how to apply or those type of things you can learn from this course. So I'm quite interested in providing the learning opportunities online. And so this course actually is, you can take this course for free at the Coursera. And also you can access to the edX, then you can just register and then taking those course for free. And if you want to take the certificate, then you pay a little bit amount of money so that you can get a certificate when you finish the course. So this is my major work, online course, providing online course and working on the research on game-based learning. So now I'll cover those topics on serious games. So I just use 10 minutes. So.
That's okay.
Okay, so actually using games, not just digital game, but also the analog games, board games or card games, is not a good, not a new idea. People just using games before the computer came or digital media is advanced like now. In the 1990s, the research field is called gaming and simulation. And business games or other type of games are studied in that field. And also, entertainment education is a part of the research field that is interested in using games. Like cartoons or anime, you can include some of the educational element and providing to the students or children. Then students can learn incidentally along with just watching and enjoying the anime or cartoons. It's same thing with the games. Students can play games and then incidentally they can learn some elements of the educational elements. So it, the field called some of the people just starting using the term edutainment in 1990s. And also in the 2000s, serious games is the sort of the buzzword or the term we used to diffuse the idea of using games for education or other social issues. So earlier example, one of the early examples is Monopoly, you know Monopoly, but this game is produced as an educational game at the beginning. So this was, it was 1920s or 1930s. So you can learn the concept of taxation or the monopolize the real estate or so, the sort of thing. And there are in 80s and 90s, there are several type of business games on the Famicom, family computer, Nintendo Entertainment Systems. Koei released several games working with some universities. So you can learn about how to manage the company with these games. This is the sort of the business simulation game. And one of the successful examples when the serious games movement started, this is a game called Virtual U. This is a game like a SimCity, you know, SimCity. This is a game to manage the university, how to manage university and then getting more enrollments or getting more money for the funding to the to do the research, or those type of higher education version of SimCity is produced in 2000. And this game is used at the MBA or higher education professional training programs in the US and also other countries. This is, game is in English, so some, So this game is used at some of the those educational programs. So, and because this game was successful, and then the people at the public sectors are interested in using games for some issues in public sectors, like policy management or type of thing. The people at the, those sectors start interested in games, and then they start funding those projects. This is an early example of in the healthcare field, the game called The Journey to Wild Divine. This game is an early example of using the bio feedback sensors. So you put some device, sensor device on your finger, and then you just control your physiological self-control and control the game players so that they, you can play better in the game. Like you can just control your breath, then you see that the ball is just flowing up, or those type of games. You see the several mini games in the game. After this game released, you see lots of other examples like Wii Fit or Nintendo Wii produced some several healthcare related games, right? But this is one of the early examples. And now you see lots of several other games using sensors, right? And now the smartwatch is a good device to use for this kind of game. And this is also an example of the public project using games. You know, Dance Dance Revolution is a music game. And state of West Virginia in the US, they implemented the Dance Dance Revolution in the public schools. And this is a joint project, joint research project among the government, university, and the insurance association, and game publisher, and the stores. So they collaborated together to do this type of project. So there are several educational programs using Dance Dance Revolution is designed and then implemented in the school environment. Like it was in the classroom, and then that was a part of the after school activity. And then they also created a lesson plan for the physical education as well. So it was 5-year project, and then they got a very good research outcomes. Okay, so yes, this is the environment, the context in Japan. The in 2002, do you know the game no kyofu? It's translated in the terror of the game brain is released in 2002, and 10 years after, the same publisher actually published a game, the book called "Game ni sureba umaku iku," which is translated as "Make it a game and you'll be fine," those type of thing. And so this is after the movement of gamification started. So the movement of gamification influenced the people's public acceptance of games. People just scared about the video game, by the video games, because it's children so engaged in playing and taking too much time. But nowadays, people understand that a game could be used for to control or to help the students to do the better behavior. So the public acceptance is changing now for in 10 years. And still it's changing, but still there's some negative people still exist. So it's not totally changed, and then people, everyone is not welcome to use the games as a tool to changing the social, for the social problem solving. So here's that was a brief overview. Then now I can explain, I'll explain that about the current trends of serious games. So here's some topics about current trends. First one is this field is established as an emerging research field. So and also it's becoming a social layer to engage people. And then now the people are interested in how you can evaluate or how you can measure the outcome of using games. And that type of research is going on right now. So in 2000, we have, in these 10 years, we got lots of research articles just in the educational field. This is the number of peer-reviewed articles just in the education database, one of the education database. If you count other research field, then the number is more, actually. But only if you look at the education field, the number is increasing. And if you go look at some publishers on academic articles, this is one of the examples that the publisher of IGI Global, they produce several books on handbooks or research paper books regarding CS games and game-based learning in different type of areas, like a serious game for healthcare is one of them, and there's several other research papers already published. And also there are several conferences just focusing on game-based learning and serious games. GLS conference is hosted by the University of Wisconsin-Madison. They are doing this conference for 10 years, and each year 3 days conference, and then all of the sessions are regarding online game-based learning. And there are several other conferences focusing on healthcare field, like game for health conference or health games for health conference in Europe, or there are several other conferences. And there are several research institutes and research centers is hosted by several universities. Like I mentioned, University of Wisconsin is organized the Game Learning Society Institute. And also, if you look at some other universities in EU, then they have several research consortium funded by European Union. And also some companies like Microsoft offer some research grant to form sort of consortium. And if you look at the Game for Health, then you'll see a lot of examples already conducted in this field. They have done several researches since 2004, so it's been more than 10 years. And this community, research community, is supported by Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. They invest a lot of money in this area. And then if you go to the website on Center for Digital Game Research, this is hosted by UC Santa Barbara, the University of California, Santa Barbara. They also funded by Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. And they have a database on game-based learning for healthcare field. So if you are looking for some example, then this is the one you want to check. And research outcomes and some game examples and some lesson plans, how to use games in your classroom. There are several examples already exist, so you should check before you do on your own study. And also, there's a growing field called Games for Health Europe. They are very enthusiastic now. They are well funded by European Union. Then recently they had a conference in Netherlands. So if you check on this website, then you see the program, that's what kind of research is going on right now. So this is another example that is widely implemented to help people to recover from their problem, a health problem or mental problems. This is designed by Jane McGonigal, one of the very famous game designer on doing this type of research and practice. This application is called Super Beta. This is a mobile game, a mobile application you can use with your smartphone. And then the application supports you to recover from some sort of problem. This game provides you a lot of quests. Quest means assignment. And you can try the small piece of assignment, then you can be you can recover from your problem. That is the one idea of using game mechanics, into the to solve the problem, some sort of health problem or social problem. And this is another example that game based. So some of the game designers working together to create a new school curriculum. So this is the school called Quest to Learn. This school is established in the New York City as a public school. And also there's a school called Chicago Quest. It is also the international charter school in Chicago. It started in 2011. And there's a school called Playmaker School, which is established in 2012 in California. these schools are designed with a collaboration between game designers and educators, and then funded by non-profit organization. Then they created curriculum, lesson plans, and then game-based tools to learn. So this is a video I show you. This video is available in Vimeo, and then this shows about the playmaker school. That is this one, the third one. This video shows that about what the students doing in the environment of playmaker school. Okay, so you see a lot of things are going on here, right? Then the school curriculum is totally different from the traditional school curriculum. So, and yeah, if you are well funded, then this kind of school curriculum can be implemented. And you have to work with good engineers and good game designers to do that. Not just doing the effort by the researchers or the expert in the field. It's very difficult to implement or incorporate with the idea of game design. So, and also there's other examples. The United States government, the White House, hosted an event called the Serious Games Jam. Game Jam is the event that you just getting together in a few days, just you create a game in a very short time, like one day or 2 days. This is a 2-day event that the educators and game designers, researchers are getting together and then create educational games. So this type of games are produced by the joint effort by the educational practitioners and subject matter experts and also game designers. So the US government is interested in producing, utilizing the digital media and the concept of games to create a better educational environment for the public school and then the entire educational schools, anyway. So this is one example of how you can bring people and getting interested in the field. Like if you create a games regarding healthcare, how to solve the problem with the games in some sort of problems in healthcare field, then you can start up with this type of event. So that the participants can learn through making a game. So, and the other topic about the current trend of serious games is game-based assessment. There's a growing interest in how we can measure and assess the game-based learning outcomes. And this is an institute called GrassLab. GrassLab is started up by the Institute of Play, which is a non-profit research unit, and also Electronic Arts, which is a big game company. They funded this project and then started up research with people like the researchers at the Educational Testing Services. ETS is one produced TOEFL and then GRE or those type of tests. The researchers from ETS and then game designer from Institute of Play and then the game designer from Electronic Arts, they are working together to do the how we can create a measurement on game-based learning. And also they produced some entertainment games into classroom, like SimCity Education is produced by GrassLab. So you can use SimCity in your classroom they produce several lesson plans and also some of the scenarios, so that is more educational elements are included in the scenario, and then you can use seamlessly in the classroom. Then, so the final topic today is the future perspectives. I go through quickly this part and then give you one good example. So in the future, well, now currently it is going like the convergence of play and learning is occurring now. And also there's still some challenges exist. So we have to discuss about the challenges, how we can overcome the challenges. So here's one example. The game called Rocksmith is produced by UBI Soft Entertainment. This game is the kind of a guitar simulator. You can play with your actual guitar, the real guitar, and then you play the game. I'll show the video. This video is available on YouTube. The girl's name is Audrey. She started playing this Rocksmith when she was 8 years old. Yeah, this one. This is 2 years later. She's now 10 years old in this video. Then you can see the recent one. Actually, not recent, but this is also the last year. So 3 years after the first one. She's now 11 years old in this video. Then she looks really professional now. Okay, so you see that she's just keep improving her skill, right? And yeah, now her father is really proud of them. Then he keeps posting their play on YouTube. So you can see the recent result if you go to YouTube and then search the Rocksmith Audrey, then you can see the recent one. You see that, so now this type of technology, it's a sort of adaptive learning technology. If you are getting better, then it's getting more difficult. And then the game detects your progress, and then it's just adapt with your skill. If you are not doing well, then the game makes the play very easier. So this is another example. This is produced from our project, one of our project, the game called JobStar. JobStar is a game, card game, to help you think about your future career. This is game is used, can be used for your career education. This game is very simple. You play with several cards. You have the job card, and then think about, in this context, maturing society, and then in the industry of transportation and shipping, then what kind of job is needed in this situation. Then you think about from engineer, or those, you have several type of jobs on your hand, and then you think about like this sort of designer will be needed in this context. Then you will present what kind of job you created. You have to be very creative. Mm-hmm. And then you think about your new job, and then present to others, and then just present each other. Then you will see how people can think about a new future and then new job. Mm-hmm. So this game, we created this game in a card game version. Now we are producing online game version. And this is the expected effect of using JobStar. We did a preliminary research, And then we found that student changing view on the playing the painful shukatsu. Shukatsu is very painful. Finding job is very painful because they have to be really think about yourself and then considering what kind of job I can do. But it's kind of painful process. But in using this game, you can just keep away from yourself, but you can think about the future. And then what kind of job is interesting? Then you will find, this job is interesting, then I want to do that. So you can totally change the view from the regarding the shukatsu, the job hunting. The student overview is defined. Students can overview the different type of job using game, like a designer, engineer, that is, you have never think about. And also you can think about the future, what kind of future is going ahead. Then you find out your dream job, or you can create your own job. So through this game, learning occurs incidentally while playing and enjoying the game with others. And then you can also learn in the social learning environment. Other players can come up with different idea, then you can learn from that idea, and then you can think better idea. That is the game mechanics of this game. So, but still, we have several challenges in the future of CS games. The product is keep changing, and you see that there are several major advancement, major innovation of the game hardware. Then we used to play Family Computer, which is a Nintendo Entertainment System, and it was a huge hit. And then the market totally changed. And then after that, PlayStation 1 and the Super Family Computer, and there are several type of game hardware is released, and the market changed. So it's difficult to catching up with those type of rapid changing of technology. Now, Wii is now outdated, and then Wii U and the next one is coming from Nintendo. So we used to use Wii technology in 10 years ago, but nowadays we have to use other technology to keep up with. If you want to diffuse your technology or your game, then just making a good game is not the solution. You have to think about the marketing as well. So that is very difficult. And also you have to think about the negative side of using gamification. Gamification can be used as a tool to control people or manipulate, diffuse people. Deceive people or manipulate and then doing the bad things. Producing a bad behavior is possible if you use a gamification technology. So not just providing the good technology, you have to also educate people about game literacy, how you can use wisely, or why this game is used in good way is very important. So increasing social awareness and game literacy is also important when you are working on gamification and CS games. And here's some suggestions from me. If you think about your project, then come up with a very good idea, as many as possible. Not just one good idea, it's very difficult to continue with that. So putting the good idea in your project, as many as possible. Then you can just reduce or cutting the unnecessary elements, then you can create a good plan with the idea. And you have to think well about your context. Who is the user, and why do the players really want to play your game is also important. And when and how is your game is used is also important material, important factor that you have to consider. And it is also important to think about a good cross point of playing and then what you want them to teach, you want to learn. So you don't have to use the very expensive technology. You can just create your own card game or a board game. It may work. And also, the people tend to use quiz as a solution for your game. But quiz is just one approach of using games. So if you want to use quiz as your one of major elements in your game project, then including some sort of surprise or the fun surprise, interesting surprise in the quiz element is very important. Not just asking some boring question is not a good idea, but providing a very good, interesting knowledge to know the interesting things is fun, and then producing entertaining elements. So it's important to produce when you think about a quiz, then putting the very interesting knowledge is very important as well. So these are some suggestions so that we can start the discussion, but here is some reference to study further. I gave you some examples in this lecture, but also you can download some of the, this is unfortunately in Japanese, so you don't have to use that, but these are the translated versions, so you can read in English the original version of Super Better and Reality is Broken. They have the very good examples of how you can implement the game element into the actual social context. So try to read the J. McGonigal's book if you want to get more idea about game design. So that's all from me. So thank you very much.